Well, thank you, John, for the kind introduction. I think, I don't know if I would say the commitment quality is not what it should be. I don't know if I would have phrased it exactly in that way, but I do have an intense passion for quality and quality management. I've been interested in it for the past few years, and especially over the past year, I've become more and more passionate about it. So I'm really excited to talk to you about it. I hopefully won't bore you to tears with the topic, because I think sometimes people hear the word quality and they kind of go, But it's something that I think is interesting and is going to become more and more a part of the future. So I have no potential conflicts of interest to disclose. So just as an outline of what we'll be talking about today, I'll be talking about some case studies in quality management throughout the presentation. We'll be contrasting the difference between quality and compliance. We'll be evaluating some of the characteristics of excellent organizations. We'll assess patient blood management opportunities that could improve quality and patient outcomes. And we'll consider future directions and how we can work toward becoming a quote unquote best-in-class organization. So the first case study is probably, I thought I'd start with the most important case study. I guess the answer we know already is Moonlight. We think probably is Moonlight. I'm sure they're doing a root cause analysis at this point in time and probably a corrective and preventive action. But all right, but seriously, so the first case study has to do with the platelet transfusion. And this is just a very simple anecdotal case. So a newly admitted hematology oncology patient came to UWMC, and the RN near the end of the shift tried to initiate some orders, and ORCA froze for that individual. So weren't able to initiate the ORCA orders. The oncoming RN tried to log into ORCA and initiate the orders for that patient. And as a part of initiating all of the orders, there was actually an order from November, and this was in January, for a platelet transfusion, and that order was initiated. The patient was transfused, and after the transfusion was completed, it was realized that the transfusion was probably not needed, as the pre-transfusion platelet count was greater than 100,000. So John Hess always says the best transfusion is the one not given, and I think in general that is sort of a motto that we can go by, because transfusion is not without risk. It is associated with adverse events, adverse reactions, and also with immune modulation. We do have an outgoing IT project request where we'd like to put in transfusion-associated lab values on the printed ORCA orders for our staff. So when somebody orders a transfusion in ORCA, we get a printed order that prints automatically within our laboratory. And currently there's not information showing what the platelet count is. And so if a lab value, for example, platelets, seems too high for transfusion, it may need a closer look. And I think that this is a great way for us to empower our staff to get them involved, because the last thing we want is for our staff not to be thinking. They're highly intelligent people, and the more we can get them to think and be engaged in their job is a great way to get them involved. And excellent organizations seek ways to empower their staff and maximize their contribution through development of staff and also their involvement. So quality, I think, sometimes is considered in the vein of compliance, and I just wanted to make a contrast really quick. I was trying to think of an analogy that we could potentially use, and when I'm outside of my transfusion life, I spend most of my time thinking about Isla. This is the light of my life, my daughter. And I was thinking about, I mean, this is sort of a joke, but if I thought about, just from a compliance standpoint, being a parent, I would be thinking about what I need to do to not get arrested, basically, right? So that's good. If I'm arrested, I probably can't be a good parent, but I think, you know, I try my best to be as good of a parent as I can be. I definitely don't always succeed, but I think, I guess, a quality approach would be, how can I be a good parent to Isla, or the best parent that I can possibly be? And in that same vein, I think we try to teach patients, treat patients as if they are our own family members. And so I thought that was actually, in the end, kind of a nice analogy of what quality is. So in the transfusion service, there are accrediting bodies. So there's CAP, there's ABB, and then there's also the Joint Commission. And then we here at UWMC are FDA registered, so we're regulated by the FDA. So what they tell us, we basically have to do. It's the word of law. And the FDA is also becoming much more interested in quality, and it's going to be shifting their direction toward quality. So they're going to be shifting from a primary goal of compliance, and we'll be driving the industry beyond compliance by focusing on quality. The core components of this Case for Quality initiative are a shift in focus to quality, enhanced data transparency, and stakeholder engagement. I wanted to talk a little bit just about some definitions related to quality. I think we hear a lot of these terms, and I thought I would just define a couple of them really quick according to ISO, the International Organization for Standardization. So quality control is a part of quality management that's focused on fulfilling quality requirements. And we think a lot of that is reagent QC, for example. I think everybody in laboratory medicine is familiar with that. Quality assurance is a part of quality management that's focused on providing confidence that quality requirements will be fulfilled. And then both quality control and quality assurance are part of quality management, along with quality planning and quality improvement. So quality management as a whole is kind of encompassing in the sense that it's the assembly and management of all activities aimed at the production of quality by organizations of various kinds, and essentially it's running a quality system well. And sort of going beyond quality management, a term that's become more in vogue is total quality management. And this has been defined as a management approach of an organization that's centered on quality based on participation of all its members and aiming at long-term success through customer satisfaction and benefits to all members of the organization and society. So I think this is sort of the thing where people breathe quality. If they were to get a tattoo, it would probably have something to do with quality. I don't know exactly what this organization looks like, but in a sense, it's supposed to be a best-in-class organization. So UWMC Transfusion Service Laboratory opened in March 2016. It's very close to my heart. We were brand new in March 2016. Now we're probably just new and not brand new. We did have some initial growing pains just related to any big change where you're developing something that is new, a new laboratory within a hospital that's very large, where much of it is relatively constant. So total quality management is probably not achievable on day one, and it's probably not achievable on year one. Since we've opened in March of 2016, we've processed 18,000 blood samples, and we've issued about 35,000 blood components. So we've been very busy, and I think successful as well. So I wanted to talk a little bit about FDA reportable events. So these are what we call biological product deviations, or BPDs, where these are errors. Essentially, if we send out something that is wrong about a blood product and it actually leaves the transfusion service, we have to report those errors to the FDA in about 45 days. Code of Federal Regulations defines this as something that is required, that we are required to report these events that affect the safety, purity, or potency of the distributed product. And so here's a look at our biological product deviations since we opened through December. And so you can see here that, okay, there's a nice decrease. So we see a nice trend. And I am excited about that. I think that's great. But what actually made me the most excited, if I find my cursor, is here. Right off the bat, we had a staff that was encouraged in a culture where they felt comfortable reporting errors. And you don't know if you have errors if people aren't comfortable reporting them. So I felt very happy that people were reporting them off the bat, and probably even more happy about that than the fact that it's been decreasing so significantly, because we still want to make sure that people are comfortable reporting, that it's a non-punitive thing if somebody makes an error and reports it on themselves. Okay, shifting gears just a little bit here, I wanted to talk a little bit about another case study looking at donor screening with respect to transfusion-transmitted babesiosis. So babesia is a parasite, and there was a case in Seattle in March 2015. And so obviously this is something that is fresh in people's minds, thinking about the risk of transfusion-transmitted babesiosis. So the question is, should we screen all red blood cell donors for babesia? That was the question we were tasked with from our blood supplier. And so babesia is a tick-transmitted intra-erythrocytic parasite. It causes a malaria-like illness, and if neonates, the elderly, or immunocompromised individuals are affected, there's about a 5 to 20% mortality rate. And we're currently not required to screen blood donors for babesia in the United States, but there have been several cases of transfusion-transmitted babesiosis since the 70s, well over 100. And so this has been on people's minds as it's been becoming more and more common. The interesting thing about babesia is that it's endemic to certain states within the U.S., particularly about 7 states in New England, and then also Minnesota and Wisconsin are endemic for this bug. Also, adults are often asymptomatic, and so they can have persistent infection for a few months. Somebody can feel well, they can come in and donate, actually have babesia and transmit it through the donation. So we looked at the UW system. Overall, the UW system transfuses about 34,000 red blood cell components per year. We looked just at the red blood cell components because remember this is an intraerythrocytic parasite. And the cost per test was about $10. That's a relatively conservative estimate in the literature. Other studies have shown about $15, so $10 roughly, give or take. The risk of transfusion-transmitted babesiosis in Washington State is 1 in 10.36 million because it's a non-endemic state. It would need to be due to travel. And this is based on the most recent largest prospective study in the United States. So the cost to prevent one case would be about $103.6 million and take about 300 or more years to prevent the next case of TTB. So we decided that despite the seriousness of a recent case of TTB, we made a risk-based assessment and a decision to not require donor screening. This led to a cost savings of about $340,000 per year, but these decisions are not easily made. They're challenging. They have pros and cons. In transfusion medicine, we operate under something called the precautionary principle, where it's not sufficient to prevent recognized harms, but it's also what we need to do is prevent anticipated harms. So things that we don't really know what the exact risk is, we may want to try to prevent those as well. And being in a country that's very resourceful in the United States, an example of that would be that we are now donor screening for Zika virus in the United States, and that's been required by the FDA. So we now are required to do that. The cost to prevent one case of Zika virus transfusion transmitted is going to be extremely high, but we are fortunate to live in a country where we're able to do that. And I thought this was a nice contrast to look at a recent paper published from Zimbabwe, where they looked at whether or not to add individual donor nucleic acid testing for HIV, hepatitis B, and hepatitis C to their current serological testing regimen. And they found that it would prevent 9, 25, and 6 cases of each of those entities, respectively, per 100,000 blood donations. But the cost was actually deemed too high when considering their gross national income per capita. So I think these two examples contrast each other very nicely, and I think these decisions are not made easily. But we do feel comfortable with the babesia decision. Okay, so shifting gears to blood turnaround time, which is always important in a transfusion service, especially when you are a new transfusion service laboratory. So here we had a patient who returned from cardiac catheterization. The patient developed a retroperitoneal hematoma, and the clinical situation was rapidly evolving. So it wasn't something that was clear-cut immediately and had an obvious decision. It was rapidly evolving. The team ordered emergency cross-matched red blood cells, and then we received a customer complaint that the turnaround time was too slow, and that may have impacted patient care. So we worked to make this decision easier. In the heat of the moment in an emergency, it can be difficult to make the best decision, especially if it's a rapidly evolving decision, so we tried to simplify the process. What we have now is a new service agreement with the hospital. So here you see 3 priorities: emergency, stat, and routine. And the main change that was made was with respect to emergency. There used to be an emergency cross-matched option, and we're switching from that to emergency release uncross-matched. So the turnaround times for red blood cells, as you can see, for emergency release uncross-matched blood will be 5 minutes. If they do want cross-matched blood, it's going to take additional time. And I think having that clear-cut decision up front will make it easier for teams to make an informed decision when choosing which blood to provide. So So as I mentioned, we developed a service agreement with expected turnaround times, and this is also a cap requirement. So we fulfilled the cap requirement, and we've received no customer complaints with respect to turnaround time and emergencies since, but we're also still in the training phase and implementation phase in Orca. In addition to that, we've done some emergency bleeding simulations. These are in progress with early positive feedback, and those have been spearheaded by my colleague, Dr. Monica Pagano. Okay, and now I wanted to spend probably the other half of the talk talking about patient blood management. So the Society for the Advancement of Blood Management defines PBM as the timely application of evidence-based medical and surgical concepts designed to maintain hemoglobin concentration, optimize hemostasis, and minimize blood loss in an effort to improve patient outcomes. And so the most important thing, of course, are patient outcomes. That's what we care most about, and we want to manage their blood as judiciously as possible. I really like this recent paper from Transfusion Medicine Reviews in 2017, where there was an international expert committee on patient blood management, where they came up with not just what should we do, what's appropriate to transfuse patients, for example, but they actually had an implementation guide for how you can implement a patient blood management program. And so their paper, they suggest a bundled approach of six different bundles related to patient blood management. You have project management, managing a patient's anemia, optimizing a patient's coagulopathy, using interdisciplinary blood conservation, using patient-centered decision-making, and finally having data, using quality metrics and benchmarks. And within these six bundles, there are actually a total of 107 items that you can use. So there's pretty granular options with how to get involved with and implement a patient blood management program. Okay, so one of the things that you can do out of those 107 things is to look at wastage with respect to your blood products. So we've been looking closely at those, which we're essentially required to do as part of Transfusion Committee, and it's something that we're interested in, all transfusion services do. And you can see that the published wastage rate for red cells, plasma, and platelets, and cryo precipitate are as follows, up above there. And then our wastage rates for the year of 2016 at UWMC were 1.7%, 10.6%, 2.1%, and 11.7%. So overall, I think we're doing okay, but I think there may have been opportunities for us to look at plasma and cryoprecipitate to see if we can reduce our wastage to be more in line with the national averages. So back in September, we did an audit looking at all of our wastage rates to look at overall trends, and you could see that the plasma wastage rate has been around 10%, about 11% per year, just as I mentioned. It's been pretty steady. And cryoprecipitate's been pretty variable, but also a little bit high. We use a lot less cryoprecipitate overall, so we decided that maybe it would be best to focus on plasma since we transfuse more plasma. So here we did a targeted audit from July to September of 2016, and this is a Pareto analysis looking to see what were the most common causes for why we wasted a blood product, specifically plasma. And so you can see here that we basically get to the 80% threshold just looking at expired units. So we decided to look a little bit more closely at expired units. So closer investigation showed thawed plasma was often allocated to multiple patients, for example, 3 to 4 times over its 5-day shelf life. So we have cycles of issuing blood to patients, not transfusing the unit, and then returning it to the Transfusion Service Laboratory. And so we noticed this. I talked to our manager, Deanne, about it, and she worked with staff to focus on inventory management, specifically with these cycled plasma units. And they did a fantastic job. So here you could see, after that September audit, we've had a nice decrease in the overall wastage rate of our FFP, of our plasma. And our most recent month for which we have data, January, it was down to 3%. So it's a very nice trend. And to steal Steve's joke from last week, we should have negative wastage within a couple of months, which will be great. It was too good not to steal. So the outcome that resulted was enhanced attention by staff reduced our plasma wastage rates. So excellent job by our manager and by our staff to work on improving our plasma wastage. So this made us look and say, okay, if we're cycling these units back and forth quite a bit, let's take a look, if we can, a little bit more closely at the ordering practices. So this is what our plasma operations and activities were using a data set that's from about a 6-month period toward the end of 2016 and then annualizing those data. So to annualize those data, we allocate about 10,000 units of plasma to a patient per year. Of those 10,000 units, we'll issue about 8,000 of them. And then of those units, about 5,600 or so will be transfused to the patients. So the allocated to transfused ratio is 1.8. This would be similar to like a CT ratio, a cross-match to transfused ratio. And the issued to transfused ratio is about 1.4. So units that are issued and returned per year are projected to be about 22 to 2300 units. So when we issue a unit of plasma, there's about a 30% chance that a unit we issue will be returned to us. So how much work does this take? We wanted to get a better idea of how much time we're spending doing this and sort of what's the overall cost to our organization. In order to do this, we made some assumptions. So units that we're considering here are issued to the operating room and returned from the operating room. Not every unit of plasma that we issue is issued to the operating room, but that's an assumption that we made here. We assume that about 2 units are returned at a time. Sometimes we'll have 1 unit that's returned, sometimes we'll have 4 units that are returned, so we made the assumption that 2 is about average, and that any rework includes steps that were repeated from subsequent cycles. So if we look at the work performed, here we have plasma. So for plasma, if we're going to issue a unit of plasma, we're going to prep it for the OR, we're going to eventually issue it to a patient, and then it may get transfused. If it doesn't get transfused, then it would be returned using the portable refrigerator back to our transfusion service, and we would need to put it back into our inventory. And so once it gets back to that point, we have thawed plasma that expires in 5 days. We could then use it for another patient. And so when you use it for another patient, you're now repeating certain steps. And so the steps that are with an asterisk are the ones that are repeated. So here we have, if you have a new patient, they need an order. So you have an order, you need to receive the order and so forth. So looking at all those extra steps, it takes a certain amount of time. Also, discarding plasma takes about 10 minutes. Now, not all units are discarded. We saw what the overall number roughly of discarded units of plasma was. In the hundreds. So ignoring discard, we spend about 450, 500 hours per year and about $14,000 per year issuing and returning ordered plasma units that were not transfused. Okay, so potentially an opportunity. There are other institutions that have published sort of similar studies, similar numbers. And the most recent one, which is a big prominent institution, uses fresh frozen plasma. It does outdate in 1 day, but their rate of return was much higher than ours. So our rate of return was lower than theirs. Their wasted rate was much higher than ours. But that still doesn't mean there is still potentially an opportunity to improve and eliminate some of the repeated steps. Here we're looking at red blood cell operations and activities. So for an annualized year, we allocate about 35,000 red blood cells, issue about 27,000, and then transfuse about 21,000. So the allocated to transfused ratio, or the CT ratio, cross-matched to transfused ratio, is about 1.7. And what you often see in terms of quality metrics for the cross-matched transfused ratio is about 1.7. Less than 1.7 is what you use. So we're pretty close to the 1.7. The issued to transfused ratio is 1.3, and some people find that very useful if you end up having a lot of products in coolers or in portable refrigerators like we have. That can be informative to show you, are you issuing a lot of units but not transfusing them? So I think overall our ratios are looking decent, pretty good. We are not a trauma hospital on the one hand, so I think we may have some room to improve and reduce our CT ratio. Specifically when you look at the number of units, so this is a high volume activity. Annualized per year, about 6,500 units that are issued will end up being returned to the transfusion service. And so about 1 in 4 red cells that we issue will be returned. So how much work does this take? Looking at the activities performed for red blood cells, it takes about 53 minutes to go through one whole cycle and then return it back to the transfusion service if it's not transfused. And then again, with the asterisks, that's where the rework would be if you needed to issue it to another patient. that amount of time, so the total time for one cycle would be about 53 minutes, including the return, and then the additional repeated activities would be about 30 minutes, for example, for a red blood cell. Discarding red blood cells, again, takes about 10 minutes, and you're increasing your likelihood of discard if you're cycling units back and forth, back and forth. So ignoring discard, we spend about 1,650 hours per year and about $50,000 per year issuing and returning red blood cells that were not transfused. So there are some repeated and extra steps there, and we could potentially improve how much we order for specific procedures in the operating room to limit the amount that we actually issue and then subsequently return to the transfusion service. So in terms of next steps, we'll be collaborating with cardiothoracic surgery and anesthesia on a QI project. I've been providing them with a little bit of data. In general, working with key stakeholders in the operating room to reduce potentially unnecessary blood product ordering and issuing. And then also there's a committee that's working on developing, I'm not involved with this, but there's a committee working on developing what's called a maximal surgical blood ordering schedule, or a MSBOS, or a guideline, for example, that tells you for each procedure that tends to use blood, like a CABG, for example, coronary artery bypass graft, this is the guideline for how much blood you should order for that particular procedure. And that sort of standardizes things. And if people tend to order maybe more than they should, this can be a guideline to help. And it's meant to be data-driven, too, for the institution. So your MSBOS would say, okay, what do we typically use for this procedure? 90% or whatever of those cases fit within this range. And so that's what our maximal number we should order prior to surgery should be. Okay. So the next question we had was, how much do we transfuse and is it appropriate? So there, I could spend well over an hour talking about all the trials that have been done, and many people have spoken about this all over the world. But I wanted to summarize in one slide, liberal versus restrictive transfusion strategies. So Jeff Carson's group has a Cochrane review in 2016 that summarized a lot of the major randomized controlled trials looking at transfusion, a liberal versus a restrictive transfusion threshold. So a liberal threshold would be like 9 grams of hemoglobin per deciliter, for example, for a patient. That would be your threshold for transfusing, whereas restrictive would be 7 grams per deciliter of hemoglobin. That's one example. Should we wait till they get down to 7 to transfuse, or should we wait only until they get down to 9 to transfuse? And this has been studied in a range of clinical scenarios using large randomized controlled trials. What they found when they compiled the data was that restrictive thresholds resulted in a 43% reduction in overall transfusions. There was no difference in 30-day mortality or morbidity, no difference in the rate of infection in this large study. There was a meta-analysis in JAMA a few years prior to that that did suggest that 1 in 20 patients would develop an infection due to liberal transfusion strategy, but this is a larger database of patients, and it suggested that there was no increased risk in infection. There are insufficient data for certain patient populations, but because restrictive in so many patient populations has been shown to at least be non-inferior to liberal transfusion thresholds, in general, you may want to consider using a restrictive transfusion threshold. I think most agree that in cardiac setting, if somebody has cardiac disease, if they needed cardiac surgery, we would go a little bit higher to like 8 grams of grams per deciliter of hemoglobin. This is just a summary slide of the Choosing Wisely campaign that the AABB has. And number one on the Choosing Wisely campaign is don't transfuse more units of blood than are absolutely necessary. It talks about using restrictive thresholds of 7 or 8 grams per deciliter of hemoglobin, or 21 versus 24 for hematocrit in hemodynamically stable hospitalized patients. And it also says to give 1 transfusion rather than 2, unless it's absolutely necessary to give 2 transfusions. The ABB recently sent out an email about their revised core values, and I thought it was interesting in light of what I had been reading about the FDA's case for quality. They have respect, integrity, transparency, and excellence as their core values. And I thought the transparency, I was thinking about that, and I was thinking about data transparency that the FDA was talking about, and trying to think about how we can look at our utilization rates, or any hospital can look at their utilization rates in a way to say, how are we doing relative to our peers? So here we have utilization of blood components per year at UW Medical Center. And so you can see that this can tell you some things. It could tell you whether or not you're consistent from year to year, the number of transfusions that you give. And so you can see our red blood cells have been relatively steady from year to year. Our platelets have been relatively steady from year to year too. And then plasma, I don't really know what to tell you about plasma because it's been all over the map. We're pretty confident that the data we have for 2016 are accurate. And that's about 4,000 units, which is a lot lower than the previous year. One factor is that we've started to use jumbo plasmas, which are basically two units of plasma in one bag. And if we're counting them by each bag, that may be a little bit of a confounder here. We only started doing that for the past several months, so it shouldn't account for all of those units that were transfused in 2015, but it may account for some. Okay, so that can tell you what your trend is, how you're doing from year to year. But I was thinking, okay, what else can we look at? I had made this chart a while ago, so the 2016 data are actually a little bit older and I had annualized them at the time, so they're not the true 2016 data, but they're relatively accurate. So here you can see again our rates of red cell, plasma, and platelet transfusions in the context of how busy we are. So how many discharges do we have in the hospital, and the case mix index, which is a measure of how sick our patients are with respect to diagnosis-related groups for Medicare billing. And so you can see our patients are getting more complex and sicker every single year on a relatively steady basis, while the amount we transfuse and how busy we are has been relatively steady. Okay, so the University Healthcare Consortium, which is now called Vizient, has data, and there are a bunch of different large academic hospitals that use data to compare one hospital to the next. And what they use, at the bottom you can see, when they look at discharges, how busy a hospital is, rather than looking at discharges or adjusted discharges, they use what are called ODB discharges, or operational database discharges. And these exclude normal newborn encounters and clinical research subjects. And UWMC uses this for peer group comparisons. So you can use the case mix index, the CMI, how sick the patients are. You can weight how much you transfuse to how sick the patients are and how busy you are. So looking at that, you can see here, if I can find my cursor again, that RBCs have been relatively steady, maybe even slightly decreasing. Platelets have been relatively steady, and then plasma again. I don't know what to tell you about plasma. So I was able to get some data from Vizient to see how we compared with comparator hospitals, looking at total transfusion expense that are area wage adjusted. So depending on the region you live, what are the salaries and so forth. It's adjusted for how sick the patients are, looking at the case mix index, and it's also adjusted for discharges. And based on that data set, we were in the 95th percentile for how much we at least spend on transfusion medicine. So I wanted to look a little bit more closely to see, could we find some other comparator hospitals within that analysis to see actually how much they transfuse, and could we try to get some sort of an apples to apples comparison to get a better idea of where we are? So what does this mean? This alone, I don't know, is the answer. So looking at an 80th percentile comparator hospital that has essentially the same services that we provide here at UWMC, and it doesn't have trauma, just as we don't have trauma at UWMC. So again, they were at the 80th percentile, and if we look at the number of units that they transfuse, red cells, FFP is plasma, and platelets, per CMI weighted operational database discharge, you can get an idea of how much you transfuse relative to how complex your patient population is and how busy you are. And so these were our numbers from 2016. I'm finding my cursor again. And these are the numbers from the comparator hospital from 2016. So it looks like we transfused more red blood cells by a little bit, they transfused more plasma, and we transfused more platelets. So what does this mean? So the cost of a transfusion, how much does it cost to transfuse somebody? So it's about $200 roughly, give or take, for a red blood cell, and that's called the acquisition cost. So that's what you're paying for the unit. When you look at the total activity-based cost model, So all the activities that go into performing a transfusion for an individual, you need to multiply it by about four or so to get about $800. That was from a 2010 paper. There have been more recent studies to suggest maybe it's a little bit higher than that, and certainly there's been inflation that you may need to adjust for. So it may be $800. I used 800 here. You could use 1,000, for example, as well. So if we were to go from the 95th to the 80th percentile, we would transfuse 1,700 fewer red blood cells per year. Based on this analysis, we would transfuse 1,700 more FFP per year and 4,200 fewer platelets per year. And looking at the approximate cost per unit, the total acquisition cost savings to go from the 95th to the 85th to the 80th percentile, looking at granular data I was able to get from the 80th percentile hospital, which I have never worked at previously, by the way, the total acquisition cost savings per year would be about $2.8 million. And then looking at the total activity-based costs, you would multiply that factor by about 2 to 4. So there's potential significant savings. In addition to that, the transfusion-related adverse events avoided per year would be about 76 events. I was also able to get some data from a 7th percentile comparator hospital. These data were from 2015, so I used UWMC data from 2015 as well. Now keep in mind that plasma transfusion rate was much higher in 2015, so I don't really know what that means. But if you are looking at cost, plasma is a much lower cost item. So again, you could see our red cells. Let me find the cursor again. Okay, so we transfuse what appears to be quite a bit more red blood cells per CMI weighted ODB discharge. More plasma that year, and then more platelets per CMI-weighted ODB discharge. And looking at that, we would transfuse about 22,000 fewer components per year. And looking at the potential acquisition cost savings per year, that would be about $6 million, or a little bit more than $6 million, with a total activity-based cost savings per year of about 2 to 4 factors beyond that. Transfusion-related adverse events avoided per year would be about 250 potentially. So am I saying we need to get to whatever the 7th percentile hospital is? Absolutely not. I don't necessarily think that they are harming patients, but I don't think that we need to get there. I don't think that that is going to be practically feasible to get there. We do have a very complex patient population here, and I think it would be challenging to get to that point. But we could ask the question, should we consider what it would take to get to the 50th percentile and what we would need to do to get there? And could that potentially, most importantly, improve patient outcomes? So I don't think I have all the answers as to how we would be able to do that. Again, there are implementation guides for how to implement patient blood management programs. There are patient blood management activities currently going on here at UWMC, and there are many different ways to approach PBM. Question would be, should we try more aggressive or different avenues with respect to patient blood management? Can we look at more granular data with respect to certain services that potentially use a lot of blood? Some services are required to report how much they transfuse to a national reporting system. And so they know how they compare with other people already, and that data exists. So if you can identify areas to target, then you could potentially come up with an intervention to provide cost-effective, improved patient care. And I've always found this to be a salient article. This was a perspective piece in the New England Journal of Medicine from 2016, talking about the science of choosing wisely and overcoming the therapeutic illusion that they call. And I won't go over the entire perspective piece, I will spare you that, but they talk about the success of efforts from the Choosing Wisely campaign may be limited by the tendency of human beings to overestimate the effects of their actions. And so we are all psychologically programmed to want to do something to help patients. And if the patient gets better, we can attribute our actions potentially to that patient improving. And so an example of that, I am guilty of recommending Benadryl and Tylenol pre-medication for patients who have a history of transfusion reactions. And that's not necessarily evidence-based, but I do it, okay? If a patient that I recommend Benadryl for to prevent an allergic transfusion reaction doesn't get an allergic transfusion reaction, I probably subconsciously am giving myself some credit for that. So you know, this is something that we're all, it's difficult to get anybody to have a behavior change, and it's challenging, and that's why you need a whole system. And the bundle number one, project management, that I talked about is extremely important, where you get all stakeholders together, you have the leaders of the hospital, you're getting nursing involved, everybody's involved with the common goal of providing the best patient blood management possible. I just wanted to show very briefly data that John Hess had from Harborview's utilization looking back to 2003. So their utilization rates for blood has gone down strikingly since 2003 and relatively steadily. Exactly what the reason for that reduction is, I don't know. I don't have the answer for that. One hypothesis is a lot of large randomized controlled trials started coming out in the late 90s. So in 1999, Paul Hebert's trial showing a restrictive transfusion strategy in ICU patients came out rather than a liberal transfusion strategy. And so applying evidence-based medicine as large randomized controlled trials come out and inform best practices has led in many areas a reduction in transfusions relative to how much people used to transfuse. And it's not to say that less is always better. We could go too low, and we could potentially cause patient harms as well. So we need to be cognizant about what we think the best level is to transfuse patients and try to achieve that and work hard with all stakeholders as a system to be able to do it. Because we here at UWMC issue about 100, 110 blood components per day. So that's a lot of decisions that people are making, right? I can't be there next to every single one of them, or John or Monica or Terry can't be next to every single person who's making a decision whether or not they're going to order a transfusion. And so you need to build a system where you're educating people, you're empowering them to make well-informed decisions on their own. So in summary, I'm fortunate to work with incredible people and an incredible department. I want to say lab medicine is an incredible department. I think it's fantastic. I don't want to throw it under the bus in any way. Healthcare is moving beyond compliance in the direction of quality. It's important to encourage staff to report issues by having a non-punitive team-oriented atmosphere. And that's kind of what I was talking about with the reporting FDA reportable errors. I want people to feel comfortable to be able to do that. We were able to reduce plasma wastage by our staff's effective inventory management. And want to thank them and our manager, Deanne, for making that happen. There may be an opportunity to improve blood ordering practices from the operating room. And finally, bird's eye view patient blood management comparator data could potentially be useful as an internal audit technique to inform future directions for patient blood management. So what are some potential future directions? So looking at our plasma wastage in a little bit more detail, we're doing well, but the ones that we still waste tend to be ABs, and those are the ones that we have in our, and I know Dan's an AB, those are the ones that we tend to have in our emergency supply. So we're saving those for an emergency situation, but as they get closer to expiry, we could pay more close attention to inventory management of those. I think we're doing a very good job already, but those, if we wanted to even lower it more, that's something we could potentially focus even more on. We'll continue to work with stakeholders to optimize blood product ordering and issuing to the OR. Consider additional evidence-based patient blood management initiatives to improve patient outcomes, efficiency, and cost effectiveness, and use any time saved in our transfusion service laboratory to engage our excellent staff in quality management, enhancing the laboratory's complexity and supporting research. And so I would be remiss without thanking a lot of really important people. I want to thank John Hess and Monica Pagano in particular for helping me with this talk and providing some insights. I want to thank Terry Gernsheimer. I want to thank our managers, Deanne Stevens and Nina Sen, our quality analysts, Christine Clark and G. Cruz Cody. And much of my time, because we've been new in terms of the laboratory here at UWMC, has been here at UWMC. And so I want to particularly recognize Deanne and Christine for being outstanding colleagues to work with. I've learned a lot from them both. And I also want to last but not least acknowledge UWMC and Harborview TSL, all the staff that are involved, all the hard work that you do. They're highly intelligent people who've done really fantastic work. Thanks for your attention.
was a really good talk. So in this number of units transfused over the CMI discharge index, is there a sweet, like a generally accepted sweet spot, or it's different for every place?
No, I kind of tried to figure this out as I went along as the best way that I could try to come up with comparator data. So I don't know necessarily that there's a sweet spot. I got some additional comparator data from a 75th percentile hospital. They transfuse a lot fewer platelets than the 80th percentile hospital, so the cost savings was actually a lot even more. So it depends on which units you're talking about. Platelets are the most expensive product, red cells second most, and plasma third most. But there's no, if your question is what's the standard, there is no standard. And I think, you know, going back to the FDA's point for data transparency, we may get to a point where we're able to come up with ways to share data between institutions related to transfusion medicine in a way that we can standardize to know where we are.
I guess what I'm wondering is there a way to overlay outcomes generally as a third parameter that then tells you where the sweet spot is too? It's a really interesting calculation that you've made.
There have been some studies that have reported outcomes related to patient blood management initiatives, especially a reduction in the number of transfusions. But there are so many confounding variables over that period of time that it's tough to know. So at this particular hospital that I'm thinking about, their outcomes improved significantly over that 4 or 5 year time period. But at the same time, there are so many other confounding variables, things changing at the hospital, that it's challenging. It's very difficult in transfusion medicine to get very good level one evidence as to what we should do in terms of even a restrictive versus a liberal transfusion threshold. It's challenging. The trials are extremely expensive. But I think if we can sort of crowdsource in some ways, we may be able to come up with a way to look at patient outcomes and incorporate that into just, okay, where are our peers, where are we? Can we actually tie it into outcomes in an effective way using an apples to apples comparison? And you look at the different services that we do transfuse. You've got hematology oncology, you've got trauma, you've got cardiothoracic surgery, liver transplant surgery, obstetrics, all sorts of different services that may exist at one hospital and not exist at another. So we need to adjust for that as well. I tried to do that in this sort of high level comparison that I did, but I think, you know, there are other challenges related to that. The CMI tries to adjust for that, but the CMI doesn't necessarily mean tell us what's appropriate to transfuse to a patient.
So I think that was a really nice analysis of the babesiosis cost per potential, you know, infection saved. And I think it's a really stark contrast between the Zika virus. And you highlighted that a little bit, but I wonder if you could speak a little bit more about why that was not done for Zika virus and what are the implications?
Yeah, that's a great question. So the question was why are we mandated to do Zika virus donor screening and we're not mandated to do babesiosis screening? I think part of it has to do with the endemicity of babesia, that it's only in certain regions of the United States. And so is it cost effective to screen in certain regions? Yes. So many regions are screening, but others aren't. But then the margins are challenging with respect to blood donor centers, so you may not make it may be more difficult for people in endemic regions. So for babesia, it's challenging. When you look at Zika, it's an emerging threat where we don't know exactly what it's going to do. We were looking to see if there's local autochthonous spread. We thought that there maybe was, but it looks like a lot of that was actually people who did travel to Brazil. There have been, I think, last I heard, about 4 cases of transfusion-transmitted Zika in Brazil. But I don't think that it's happened at all, at least that we know of, within the United States. So you could also say that Zika was in a lot of the popular media. And so some people have said that there may have been political forces in play with respect to the decision to require mandate Zika screening in the United States.
But I summarize that as hype and uncertainty.
Sure.
Great talk, Ryan. Thank you. I wanted to ask about the cost models that you did for the not transfusing, because when you talked about the wasting, the wastage products, you said if I never get a returned product, the savings were actually pretty modest in terms of labor, much more modest than I thought you were going to say. But when you talked about the activity-based costing model for never transfusing a red cell, you talked about multiplying by a factor of 2 to 4. It just doesn't seem to line up. So what is built into that activity-based costing model?
Yeah, so you hit the nail on the head. I had the same thought myself. We only looked at the activities that we're performing based on our staff and nothing else. In the total activity-based cost model, they're looking at every single step along the way that includes blood administration, additional transport, and so forth related to needing more units overall. So there's more that went into their total activity-based costs than into ours. Mine, I had to make several assumptions up front. It's a much less sophisticated analysis. So I thought it was probably a conservative estimate, just as you keyed in on, but I could probably, I think, once we get more granular data, we could probably come up with a more sophisticated way of saying, okay, how much does this cost us really per year?
Yeah, Ryan, again, thank you for such a beautiful talk. And I want to thank you and your colleagues and the other leadership in the TSL for getting us to this point. It's been a very, very busy year. I really want to thank you and acknowledge you again, both for the presentation you've made, but for all the work that you've done. And you brought up a number of issues. It would be great to have service-specific comparators, for example, for a bone marrow transplant, which is such a dominant part of the use of blood and the occupancy of this hospital. But also it raises a question, part of UW Medicine's mission statement is the health of the overall population of the region and really of the country and the world. I wanted to know what impact better blood management would have on the availability of blood product throughout the region. And are we a significant enough user that our overuse actually limits the access within the region?
That's an interesting question. I want to thank you, first of all, Mark, for your leadership. It's always a pleasure to work with you. And so if we think we are overusing, and I think the method that I was using is crude, admittedly, and so I think it could be useful to give you a bird's eye view and say if we are a somewhat outlier, that can inform our decisions as to where to go in the future. If we are, I think for any blood center, they have a fine-tuned operation that knows the ebbs and flows of how things go, and they recruit their donors as such. And so, you know, I think the way things are right now, the operation is relatively set up, but it's challenging at the same time to be able to maintain it and the constancy of that. If we were suddenly tomorrow to start transfusing, you know, half the number of units or something that we transfuse now, I think that would have a significant impact on Bloodworks, our blood supplier, and their overall operations. So that is always something that's important to consider. I think, you know, we think about what's best for patients, what's best for our hospital, and so forth, but it the whole thing is a system. And in the quality system, people always talk about what's called the vein-to-vein chain, and that starts with blood donation. And even before the vein-to-vein chain, you need somebody to recruit those people. So the overall thing is a system, and I think that's why, you know, we partner together with people as a whole system for the vein-to-vein chain to do what's best for our patients. So I think it could definitely create changes, but I think potentially adaptable changes.
So just speaking from the blood center side, there's no question that the big users in the system, when you talk about the community supply, you're talking about the large community supply. And if the big users are not using appropriately, it does affect really everyone in the system. So.
Right. And yes, very good point. So, you know, Teresa brings up an excellent point. If there's a platelet shortage, for example, we use a lot of platelets and we demand a lot of platelets, and so it can be challenging to give the other hospitals what they need in those settings, and Bloodworks needs to do some gymnastics to be able to make sure that they can supply all the patients in the region that they supply.
And just as a comment, part of the reason I raised the question is the UWMC has a daily safety briefing that you and Monica and Deanne and Christine have sometimes attended. And lab medicine very rarely actually brings problems to the table, but one of the ones that does come up is if there's a shortage of blood products such as platelets. So I think the hospital is aware of this, and therefore I think it does reflect that we have a responsibility, most importantly to our patients, but really to the region as well.
Just a comment on that, you know, when we do waste blood, I don't just think of it as, oh, money that's gone down the drain. I think of time that my staff could be doing something that they find very interesting. I think of a donor that sat in a chair all day. You know, if it's a platelet apheresis donation, that's a half a day. So there, like I said, there's the whole vein-to-vein chain that goes together as a system.
So speaking of platelets, Ryan, so why do you think it is that we are kind of like, it seemed to be outliers in terms of the amount of platelets that we're using, because that seems to me like it'd be a huge target, particularly in terms of, you know, saving costs as well as, you know, resources. So why are we, you know, using so many more platelets than that 80th percentile institution?
Well, I think we probably need to dive a little bit deeper to say where are our heaviest users. I mean, you have an idea. Hematology oncology patients get a lot of platelets because they have bone marrow failure. But I think, you know, we owe it to ourselves to get more granular data to say, okay, what is this population, what is this population, what is this population, to get a better idea. And then the other challenge is that for red blood cells, I showed the evidence I was showing you about restrictive transfusion strategies, that's all red blood cell data. For platelets, it's much harder to come by data that are sort of level one evidence to say this is what I should do in terms of a platelet transfusion. And so the question is, do we go by our experience? Do we go by smaller, you know, less robust trials to inform our decisions for how we transfuse platelets? And really, you know, the 10,000 platelet count for a prophylactic platelet transfusion, that is nicely evidence-based. Most of the other thresholds that we have are not strongly evidence-based. And you could argue, okay, so the ABB guidelines say 50,000 for a lumbar puncture. And you could say, well, the largest study that's been done in lumbar punctures, nobody bled at much lower platelet counts than that. So is 50,000 appropriate? Is it not? And then for the people who are transfusing, when you consider the editorial that I showed you, you know, they'd be more comfortable getting their patient's platelet count higher before whatever the procedure is. They think, oh, my patient's going to have a lower risk of bleeding. But if you put them into taco because you're giving them, which is transfusion-associated circulatory overload, because you gave them maybe one more platelet than they needed, you know, you're not providing them any benefit potentially, and you may be harming them. Thanks.